This video is an outreach of Unity Christian Church, 5255 South Linden Road, Swartz Creek, Michigan. I am Brenda Etheridge, pastor and teacher. Empowered by the Holy Spirit, the mission of Unity Christian Church is to lead people to Jesus Christ and to encourage one another on our faith journey. Bible readings are from the New Revised Standard Version, and commentary is from Feasting on the Word. Editing and music from the public domain by George Etheridge. Our subject today is wisdom. Our scripture is from Proverbs chapter 1, verses 20 through 33. And it reads, "Wisdom cries out in the street. In the square, she raises her voice. At the busiest corner, she cries out. At the entrance of the city gates, she speaks. How long, O simple ones, will you love being simple? How long will scoffers delight in their scoffing and fools hate knowledge? Give heed to my reproof. I will pour out my thoughts to you, and I will make my words known to you. Because I have called you and you refused, have stretched out my hands and no one heeded, and because you have ignored all my counsel and would have none of my reproof, I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when panic strikes you, like a storm, and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you. Then they will call upon me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but will not find me. Because you hate knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord, would have none of my counsel and despise all my reproof. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their way and be sated with their own devices. For waywardness kills the simple, and the complacency of fools destroys them. But those who listen to me will be secure and will live in ease without dread of disaster." Thanks be unto God for the reading and the hearing of God's word. If the Proverbs have been marginalized, the church might at times confess that our wisdom has suffered a similar fate in the culture. Many eloquent voices make claims about how to live in the real world. You know, talk show hosts and cultural commentators and seminar leaders and life coaches. The church seems to be but one voice among many, clamoring for the attention of the marketplace. The writer of this Proverbs would have understood our challenge. Lady Wisdom is a sage turned prophetess, a street preacher. She cries out in the street, in the square, she raises her voice. Like one certain of the immense urgency of her words for her audience's well-being, she adamantly appeals for attention in the streets, in the squares, at the busiest corner, at the entrance of the city gates. These are the sites of communal life, of the bustling relationships of daily life. This is where wisdom demands to be heard, not in the privacy of our homes, not in the sacredness of the temple, or even in the quiet recesses of our souls. She calls for allegiance smack in the thick of our work and our play, at busy intersections where people gather, and at the city gates where legal and commercial deals take place. Ordinary life, with its drama and busy social exchanges, with its joys and disappointments, this is wisdom's domain. Her tone is powerful because she knows that the consequences of deafness to her words is spiritual calamity. Wisdom is not particular about who follows her. She doesn't call the chosen, the holy, or the privileged, but invites anyone who will hear her. She calls to the simple, the scoffers, the one who hate knowledge. She grows impatient because she's been calling to them for a long time. The scoffers and knowledge haters obstinately refuse to heed. How long, she asked in her impatience, will you persist in your foolishness? Give heed to my reproof, she urges. But before she warns, she makes a promise. And that promise is nothing less than to reveal herself to everyone who listens. I will pour out my thoughts to you. I will make my words known to you. You see, to her listeners, she promises to disclose her mind, her inner life, to form an intimate union with them. She longs to be with them in mutuality, to find communion with them, and to become one with them. Wisdom calls everyone to a radical spirituality, to a way of being in the world and in right relationships. But wisdom is frustrated because she has tried so hard to win the people to no avail. She calls, she stretches out her hands, but they would have none of her warnings because they turn away from the life that she offers. She will turn away from them when calamity strikes and will laugh at their distress. They should have been pursuing her with the same intensity and absolute devotion with which she pursues them. This is the way to life. Wisdom's call ends with a proverb, the first half of which concludes her reproof. Waywardness kills the simple, and the complacency of fools destroys them. With the authority of wisdom of the ancestors, the proverb summarizes her warning. Failure to follow wisdom leads to death. But the proverb's second half arrives finally at the benefit of the listeners to wisdom's advice. You see, listening in Proverbs is always linked to obedience, and obedience is participation in the practices that lead to wisdom. It's like hearing and reading scripture, praying the prayers of confession and intercession, humility before others and God. This wisdom has very little to do with knowledge in service of power, and more to do with insight that is in service to God and neighbor. What she offers is true security, trust and freedom from fear, because disaster will not come to her followers. The text implies that true security comes from relationship with wisdom. She will not merely lead them, but will live with them, reveal herself through her thoughts to them, be in kinship to them. She will accompany them and keep them secure. So how do the claims of God find a hearing in a culture that bombards its inhabitants with messages about the good life? Lady Wisdom raises her voice, just as a mother might with a resistant teenager. And so the culture, as sophisticated as it is, also resists wisdom. I have called and you refused, have stretched out my hands and no one heeded. So why does the culture and sometimes the church resist wisdom? The answer lies partly in the abundant wisdom that seems to surround us. We're overwhelmed with opinions and choices and advice. In discouragement, the church has often abandoned the tradition of practical wisdom. And into this vacuum have come the therapist and the managers and the coaches, each of whom speaks clearly and confidently, even with the use of spiritual language and even religious authorization. In an insecure world, this wisdom is grounded in the voice of God, calling us into the way that leads to life. This wisdom is present among those who live in communion with God's people, and at times in resistance to the persistent refrains of the culture. At times it seems life goes smooth and constant and almost boring. But at other times, the winds and the waves crush upon us, and we're aware that the resources of wisdom are either present or absent at that moment. The fear of the Lord, which is the beginning of wisdom, is the experience of contact with a power greater than our own, before whom we give up our control. A wise person knows that she or he is not all-knowing and therefore is in need of guidance. Such a person possesses what John Calvin described as a teachable spirit. This fear of the Lord is a form of humility and reverence. And again, it is not obvious that such wisdom is valued in a culture that prefers power and control. So wisdom shows up in our lives. Often she shows up in a moment of need, a moment of crisis, a moment of fear. In the fall of 2006, she showed up for the world in the form of a grieving and forgiving Amish community. On October the 2nd, 2006, Charles Carl Roberts entered a one-room schoolhouse in the Amish community of Nickel Mines, Pennsylvania. He lined up 10 young girls from the school and he shot each at point blank range, killing 5 of them. In the face of this unspeakable atrocity, the Amish of Nichols Mines insisted that if they were to be true to their faith, true to their heritage, true to the memory of these innocent victims, they must not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. They said that they would find a way to forgive. They embraced and cared for the families of not only the victims, but also the family of the shooter. To a country that speaks the language of revenge very well, to a people often addicted to the hope of getting even, the Amish said there's another way, a better way. Their story is eloquent testimony to the truth that wisdom shows up in our lives, often in ways that we do not expect. When we forget about the ways of God, we often get ourselves into some terrible predicaments. When we think we are beyond the basic lessons of loving justice and doing kindness and walking humbly with God, we often end up doing things and saying things that we regret. When loving God and loving neighbor as we love ourselves are mere platitudes for us, it seems that disaster often finds us. It will always be true that bad things happen to good people and good things happen to bad people. It will also always be true that we have some responsibility for what happens to our families, our communities, our world, and ourselves. We need to pay attention to the brass message that wisdom says when she insists that fear of God is the beginning of knowledge. When people take time to listen to those they disagree with, when we often find ways to move beyond our tension-laden conflicts, conflicts that consume and destroy us, when we find ways to honor God, simple, time-tested ways, like saying a prayer, going to church, meeting and fellowshipping with one another, we find that life can have a rhythm and a cadence that feels right. When we recognize our need to forgive and be forgiven, we find a peace that is good for our bodies, our minds, and our spirits. For Christians, Christ is the wisdom of God, and he shares the Spirit who searches, knows, and understands all with those whom God has made children and heirs. We will grow in favor as we grow in wisdom. The wise and the foolish alike, who begin anew in the kingdom of God, can listen to wisdom and find new rest. Wisdom jars us into sobriety and calls us into new lives of urgent vigilance. Beware that no one leads you astray, Jesus cautions. And he warns of the risk of being unready for the Son of Man's sudden coming. Like the Torah and the prophets, Proverbs and the teachings of James give us wisdom from above. And they teach us and become a training ground for us entering and dwelling into God's reign, into God's future. And so wisdom cries out in the church and in our culture. Some of us resist the claims of wisdom. Others of us become attentive to wisdom. And over time, with hearts inclined to understanding. Those who reject the wisdom of God are lost, reaping what they sow. But those who have ears to hear, there is the promise of the wisdom literature and the gospel, that they will abide in the shadow of God's wings, safe and secure, in the words of the hymn, from all along. Thanks be unto God. My brothers and sisters, believe the good news of God's abounding love in Jesus Christ. By confessing faith in Christ and being baptized into his church, we are given new life. Through faith and baptism, we receive a new identity, life in the Spirit, a life of wisdom. Accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Commit yourself to his ways through the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Oh God, giver of life, giver of wisdom, thank you for providing the way of faith and salvation, the way of eternal life and new identity as your child. Life with your unending love and mercy. Thank you for the power of your good news. Thank you for equipping us with the gifts of ministry and service through your Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask you to teach us to trust and depend on you. That is part of wisdom. Lord, teach us to show love and concern for others in the things we say and do. Yes, this shows wisdom. Lord, we ask for your protection and your guidance and your forgiveness. Replace our fear with faith and courage. Replace our sickness with your healing. Replace our sadness and our anxiety with your joy and your love and your peace and your hope. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, my brothers and sisters, go forth into the world to serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God and rejoice in the power of the Holy Spirit. Now may the grace of Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each of us. Amen.